Something inside me has always been there. But now it's awake. And I need help.
Nothing will stand in our way.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
I will finish what you started.
Who are you?
I'm no one. There are stories about what happened.
It's true. All of it.
The Force. It's calling to you.
May the Force be with us.
My third world.
Just let it in.
Good job, up.
Why does she get a blaster and I do?
Good job, up.
Yeah, I took a week off, so my apologies up front. My name is Jon Justice, and welcome to My Nerd World and the Star Wars podcast. Glad that you are with us again this week. Yeah, I was sick, and then I had family visiting, and a whole lot of excuses for not doing a show last week. So my apologies if you have been waiting for it. In the intro, that, the full trailer for The Force Awakens, there's that slowed down version of Han and Leia's theme, and it was the shot in the trailer with the Falcon, with Rey flying it on Jakku. Man, that gives me goosebumps every time I hear it. You know, sometimes you just need Star Wars, right? Like today, like I'm having one of those days, but I got a smile on my face. And why do I have a smile on my face, despite the fact that I really didn't have a smile on my face before I started the show this week? It's because I was going to talk about Star Wars, and I was excited to do it. All right, on the show this week, time permitting, we're going to get to your listener feedback. I got a bunch of messages and emails from you that I want to get into. We'll talk a little bit of Solo hype or lack thereof. Some interesting toy reveals, or I should say a interesting toy reveal. I'm big into collecting in the toys, and so there's one particular thing that I want to get to about Solo and a leak of one of the toys that came out that I thought was kind of cool. We'll talk about the home release. The trailer for the home release came out sometime middle of last week. Really good trailer, too. It's one of those trailers where I wonder, because it wasn't specific to the home release, apart from the fact that there were more scenes in it than perhaps a regular trailer would have been, maybe. But it's one of those trailers where you kind of go, I wonder if that was one of the trailers they had in the can to use, but never did. It's a really good trailer, though. We'll talk about what's going to be on the Blu-ray release. There's a lot of goodies on there. I'm looking forward to talking about that. We'll talk J.J. Abrams. J.J. Abrams made a comment about the backlash doing that, air quotes, thing with my fingers over The Last Jedi and his thoughts on it, which I tend to agree with for the most part. I don't think it's all of the backlash of what he mentioned, but it is a part of it. Force of Sound, a documentary put together by ABC that if you haven't watched it yet, it took me a while to kind of land on it. I had to download the ABC News app on my Xbox One to watch it there. It's not up on YouTube. They said it was available on Xbox, but I, for the life of me, couldn't find it. So I ended up downloading the app for the Xbox and watched it there. Really worth a watch. We'll get into to that. We'll talk a little bit more about how cool Rian Johnson is, because he is. Because Rian Johnson's awesome. Because he made an amazing Star Wars movie, and his love of Star Wars makes me, if it's possible, love Star Wars even more. Where I want to start today, though, is can we talk about Rey and her hair? And I know this is going to seem really oddball, but I want to talk about Rey and her hair. And something dawned on me, and it wasn't until my last viewing of The Last Jedi, which was not this past weekend, but the weekend prior, which I think makes viewing number 13 or 14, something stuck out to me. And it's hit me every single time I've seen the movie, more putting a little smile on my face than really getting into the thought process behind it. And it's one of these things that if I ever had a chance to talk to Rian Johnson, I would absolutely ask Rian Johnson about this little thing, Okay, but I want to talk about Rey's hair. And I specifically want to talk about Rey's hair in The Last Jedi. Because it changed in The Last Jedi. At a very key moment of the movie. And I'm wondering... I'm dying to know how much thought went into this particular change, especially based off of what happened right afterwards. Okay, so first off, Rey's hair was in those buns. There's a Doogles? Is that what they called them? I heard Knights of Rant talking Doggles. They had a name for it. It really made me laugh. I can't. Was it Doogles or Doggles or something like that? Or Boggles? Maybe they're little buns, Boggles. So she had the three buns right on the back of her. She had it from the beginning of when we met her all the way until this one particular moment in The Last Jedi. Now, before I get into that, that's not the first time that we saw Rey and her hair this way. And it's also not the first time that I was affected by Rey and her hair this way. As a matter of fact, I'm fairly certain that if you go back and look at last year's shows, and my apologies, I guess I could have. You know what? No, I'll do it right now. All right, so I actually paused the show just then because I went back to look to see if I could find which show it was. Didn't find the episode. I think I know right around when it was. It was sometime at the early part of 2017. I did realize there's a couple of podcasts that I actually went and named similarly, which is kind of funny. All right, so there was a podcast last year. No, this was the year before last, right? So beginning of 20. Anyway, it doesn't matter. The first time we saw the packaging for The Last Jedi, it had Poe, it had Finn, and it had Rey in the middle with her lightsaber. And the biggest takeaway from that was, one, it looked like there was a scar on her face, but the biggest thing was she had her hair down. And I remember specifically spending a big chunk of time talking about the fact that Rey's got her hair down. And it looked so different. Okay. Because she had her hair down. And look, ladies, any decent, respectable man that respects women, in my opinion, we notice these things. We do. I do. Okay? I'm not saying that in a creepy way. I'm just saying I'm a guy that respects women, and we, as guys, notice when you do change things. Okay? So, in Rey's case, it was a big deal to see her with her hair down because we hadn't seen it yet, and this was just on the packaging. All right, so you flash forward all the way to the release of The Last Jedi. And the first time that we see Rey with her hair down, I am 99% sure. As a matter of fact, let me go ahead and just do one more. I'll do one more checking of things just to make sure. All right, so technically my theory is blown out of the water. I'm still going to go with it, though, because I went back and looked at some photographs from The Last Jedi. And she does have her hair down. During The Last Jedi, specifically when she ends up going down to the dark side cave, and then she ends up seeing Kylo, and her hair is all wet and it's down. All right, so that being said, the first time we actually see it kind of done is on the Falcon when she leaves Octo to go see Kylo. Okay, you get the shot, you know, after she goes and has her confrontation with Luke, and she bails, and then you see her, she's got a new outfit on, she's closing the door on the Falcon with the Jedi books in it, okay? The part when it's really noticeable, in my opinion, though, because she looks completely done up, is when she gets in to that escape pod on the Falcon. And she's having that conversation with Chewbacca, and I want to know from Rian Johnson, because, look, Look, I love my wife, and I'm just being honest. I got a thing for Rey. Look, Daisy Ridley is beautiful, and Rey is absolutely gorgeous. I mean, there's no getting around it. She is. She's a beautiful person inside and out. And when you see her on the Falcon, right? But right when she gets into the escape pod and she's talking with Chewie, it's arguably when she looks the most stunning. She looks like she's going out on a date. And it really is, at least in my opinion, it's really noticeable when she gets into that pod. And Rian Johnson even went so far as to say that they wanted it to be kind of like a coffin. It reminds me, and only because I watched it this weekend, actually it was last weekend, E.T. was on. And it reminds me of the end of E.T. Because the viewport is circular. It reminds me of E.T. when he goes into the... when he goes into that little freezer at the end before he comes back to life. Spoiler alert. But she looks like she's going on a date. And when they show her lying horizontal and the camera, you know, the camera's showing her from the side, and she has her hair down off of her shoulders. It does. I mean, it's a really bizarre way to go on a date, lying in an escape pod that looks like a coffin, right? But I'm really, really curious at how much of that was intentionally done by Rian Johnson because of where that scene was going with her and Ben Solo. I want to know if the thought process there, and it's one of those questions too where you wonder if Rian Johnson would actually go and answer it, because if he would want to leave some ambiguity there. But it's one of those moments where it's you know, did he intentionally do her up as such to make it look like she was doing herself up for Ben? I mean, it makes sense. And I suppose without having the answer from Rian Johnson, your headcanon can kind of go there. But seeing how she obviously had that connection that we've talked about in the hut before Luke went and blew the whole thing up, you know, and that was a very intimate moment. And she feels like Ben's going to turn. She tells Luke that, and then she tells Ben that. Look, it makes all the sense in the world, in my opinion, that she would do herself up to look good for Ben, right? And by the same token, right, you know, Ben Solo, you would think, would as well. He doesn't really look any different. And you do wonder, along those same lines, how much of it was he really bummed out that he didn't have his shirt on when they were force connected, right? He didn't really rush to go put a shirt on in that moment. So it's something that stuck with me. And I was, again, thinking that you didn't see her hair down until that moment in the Falcon. But really, that wasn't the case. I'm looking at a photo of her right now standing in the ring with a lightsaber ignited. And sure enough, her hair is down right there in that scene. But in the Falcon is arguably the most done up that she is up until that point throughout both movies. Interesting note, and then we'll move over to a little bit more Rian Johnson talk in this Force of Sound documentary. But next week, we will do a deep dive on The Last Jedi novel. Some people have got their hands on The Last Jedi novel and have put together a couple of different lists of all the big takeaways from the novel that aren't in the movie. And I'll give you just a bit of a hint. There's a lot of Reylo in it. I mean, it's clear that the author, which I believe was Jason Fry, it's clear he might have been the junior novel. I'll have to go look. I'll have to check that out. But it's clear that the author of both the junior novel and the novel really expanded upon the thoughts of Rey and of Kylo from the movie, and it really lends an even more depth to the, again, with my fingers, to the Reylo scenario. And kind of looking ahead, the one thing that I will share with you, and if you don't want to be spoiled, then skip ahead about 30 seconds. All right, you had enough time. In the book, apparently, it specifically mentions that Rey shuts off her connection with Kylo in the book. Now, granted, you know, that's a book, not everybody's going to read it, but that does have episode 9 implications, in my opinion, because if they state that in the, say, the crawl, maybe part of the crawl for episode 9 is what I mentioned a moment ago, so I don't spoil it, then that certainly sort of immediately explains if there's a big time jump. So next week, we'll get into a deep dive from the novel. The one thing I do want to share with you, and I didn't know this, and it turns out this particular piece of information is in the book, and I'm wondering if it was actually in the screenplay and pulled out, but the scene that I was just mentioning of the after Rey goes to the dark side cave and she has that force connection and touches fingers with Kylo Ren, this part of the movie always kind of confused me, not to the point where it took me out of the film, but it just always kind of put a bit of a question mark on there. Luke goes out to the ledge and force connects with Princess Leia. Okay. They connect, you know, she says Luke, he says Leia, and this is all happening around the same time that Rey has the force connection with the shirtless Kylo before she ends up in the dark side cave. She gets more information from Kylo before that. She finds out that she didn't find out who her parents were, and then they have the force connection. And while that's going on, you see Luke come out of his hut, and I believe it's his hut. He comes out of somewhere, and he's frantically looking for Rey. And then he sees the firelight coming from Rey's hut. I've always been curious, what was he looking for Rey for? I mean, why was he It was it, did he, I'd always kind of assumed that he felt something going on, that he felt a tremor in the Force, because in that moment he had decided to tap back into the Force to reach out to Leia. So I had always kind of just assumed that, okay, well, he obviously is feeling something. He's connected to the Force and feels like, you know, Rey is in some kind of danger or there's something going on. In the book, and again, spoiler alert here, but I really wanted to share this with you. So, in the book, apparently, the whole reason why, at least in the book, Luke was looking for Rey is because after he Force connects with Leia, he decides that he's going to leave with Rey. And so he was rushing to go find Rey to explain to her or to tell her, hey, I'm going to go with you now. He saw how injured Leia was and decided that he was going to join with Rey, only to show up to find her making a connection with Kylo slash Ben when he goes and then he blows up the temple, which was all done in camera, by the way. I think I've mentioned this before, but I'll mention it again. That they actually blew the one shot, one take. They actually blew the hut apart and with them standing there. And so then you have the confrontation with Rey and Luke now decides otherwise. Because now he sees her connection with Kylo Ren, he sees her connection with Ben, he decides this is a lost cause. She's now, you know, Force finger hooking up with him. I failed again. And so he changes his mind, which makes that scene all the more gut-wrenching. I would be curious, and again, on my list of questions, the other one, you know, being Rey in the hair and doing up, did she think she was going on a date? The other one would be, was that a part of Rian Johnson's plan, or was this just what the novel went and put in? That seems pretty specific in terms of motivation for it to be just something that the author added in on their own accord. I mean, unless he had a conversation, which is, I'm sure that they had a bunch of conversations back and forth, which is highly likely. They had a conversation back and forth talking about that particular scene, but now it makes all the sense in the world. He was actually kind of excited. Rey, you know, where are you? I'm going to come and join you. And then he ends up changing his mind when he sees that she's now, you know, doing the finger dance with Kylo Ren. He's like, you know, my name's Paul. This is between y'all. And she's off on her space date. Right? Okay. Yeah. We'll just, you know what? Let's just go with that.
Let the past die. Kill it. If you have to. The only way to become what you were meant to be.
All right, so how cool is Rian Johnson? He is this cool. So to my left here in my office slash studio slash bedroom, I have my full-size 3¾ scale Kylo Ren TIE silencer. Okay. If you push the little button behind the cockpit of Kylo Ren's TIE silencer, from the wings on the side, the panels, the missile launchers pop out, right? Okay. Rian Johnson is so cool that originally when that scene was created with the TIE silencer, when they go after the resistance towards the beginning of the film, right before, you know, his mom gets blown up out into space and then does her kick butt Mary Poppins deal. Apparently those missiles that launched into the hangar bay that blew up Tally and made me so sad. Because I like Tally. Actually, Tally's A-Wing, blue A-Wing, is parked right next to Kylo Ren's TIE silencer. They fight when I'm not podcasting. Not really, but really. So in the movie, when Kylo Ren goes and attacks the hangar of the ship, originally the missiles came out the bottom of his TIE silencer, and then he got the toy. And he saw that Hasbro went and made him come out the side. So he made ILM go back and change the ship in the movie to match the toy. That's how cool Rian Johnson is. Rian Johnson is my spirit animal. If I believed in spirit animals. I just thought that was one of the coolest things ever. All right. Force of Sound. ABC News. Mentioned it earlier. Find it. Watch it. It's about 26 minutes long. It talks about the sound design of The Last Jedi. It is worthy of your time. And again, This is why I have so much faith in Disney and Lucasfilm, and anybody else who says otherwise can stuff it in my opinion. These guys care about what they're doing. And look, because they care about what they're creating, even if it's not, and this is where the problem rests, right? Even if it's not what we envisioned in our head, they're still putting out something great. And I think that's a lot of where the problem arises, is that people have their own vision of what they're supposed to be creating, and it doesn't match their vision, and then they can't seem to get over it. That's on them. If you don't like The Last Jedi, I'm sorry. I love it. It's a fantastic movie. It's a masterpiece, in my opinion, and it disappoints me that you can't enjoy it the way that I do. But in The Force of Sound, they really, really do get into the intricacies of the sound design and the amount of effort and work that goes into it. It's really just, I love seeing the making of these films. I mean, I'll go back and watch the beginning, the full length documentary for The Phantom Menace, and it really makes me appreciate that movie. It's so funny too, because I appreciate The Phantom Menace. I always liked The Phantom Menace, but I really do love that movie. And I know it gets panned by so many people. And it really, that movie has, I always liked it, but I'm growing to love it and have started actually watching it more often. It's just weird how time and other Star Wars movies affect the previous films. I've always liked the prequels, and I'm one of the few people that really likes Attack of the Clones a lot, but I've really started to appreciate and respect The Phantom Menace even more than I did before, and it does make me wonder how The Last Jedi is going to be received in decades to come. When we get 10 years out from The Last Jedi, how are people going to be looking at that movie in retrospect? So go find Force of Sound when you get a chance. Watch it. It's worth a watch, especially if you're looking for something to tie you over until we get the home video release. Because on the home video release, we're getting a full-length feature documentary. As a matter of fact, this documentary is so detailed. Rian Johnson tweeted that this wasn't like some B-roll throwaway documentary, that this was a full-fledged documentary. As a matter of fact, they're going to be, from what I hear, they're actually going to be showing it at South by Southwest for a whole group of people. Like, it's absolutely that detailed. On top of that, we're getting a bunch of mini documentaries, a whole bunch of deleted scenes that I'm really curious to see, although going through the list, and I won't do it now, but going through the list of deleted scenes, we'll save that for when they actually come out and we can discuss them at length. It seems pretty clear the deleted scenes were stuff that they could leave on the cutting room floor. You know, I mean, The Last Jedi is already pretty dense and long at, you know, 2 hours and 20-plus minutes. Based off of the list and what I've seen of the descriptions of the deleted scenes, I'm perfectly okay with them leaving them out of the movie. We're also getting that audio commentary. Now, I don't really anticipate getting much more information from the audio commentary than what Rian Johnson has already shared with so many different people since the movie came out. What I am looking forward to, however, from that is Rian Johnson talking about what Rian Johnson wants to talk about. That is where I think we're going to get some of the good stuff, because arguably there's been questions that have not been asked of Rian Johnson about the movie, and for him sitting down and doing the full length, you know, commentary for the film, I can only imagine with how open he's been with everybody else that we're going to get some really interesting insight, seeing that this is stuff that he actually wants to talk about. And that's always the best stuff. I mean, that's how I approach my regular 9-to-5 Monday through Friday radio show. I had a consultant tell me, and I probably mentioned this before, but I'll mention it again for those of you that are new. The podcast is available on YouTube, Spreaker, Stitcher, Podbean, iTunes, and wherever other fine podcasts end up being found. But I had a consultant years and years ago, early on in my talk radio portion of my career, who said, you know, you talk about the things that you want to talk about, and that's going to be most interesting to the listener. Because even if it's not something that the listener would have chosen for themselves to go and hear commentary or opinion on, because the person that's providing the opinion and commentary is sharing it with the other person, they're enthusiastic and you're along for the ride. And that's how I really look at The Last Jedi too. This was a movie that was near and dear to Rian Johnson's heart, and so he crafted a movie that he cared deeply about, which is why for so many of us it's so great. And that's why I'm really looking forward to that, to that commentary, because I imagine that we're going to get really into what Rian Johnson wants us to know about this particular film. So March 27th is the release date for that, and I, for one, can't wait. Been thinking about going on a Last Jedi sabbatical between now and then, but I don't know if I'm going to be able to do that.
This is not going to go the way you think.
J.J. Abrams, director of Episode 7 and Episode 9, came out and was asked about the backlash to The Last Jedi, and I'm paraphrasing, but basically said that the backlash was because people were threatened by women. In a nutshell, there's some context there. That wasn't all that he said, but in a nutshell, that's what he said. Look, I tend to agree. I don't think all of the backlash was because some people were threatened by women. I think some of the backlash was because of that. I also think that there's a lot of, and I'm sorry, dudes, if you don't like it, you know, and ladies too, but I think there's a big, I don't say big, there's a portion of the Star Wars fandom that doesn't really like the romance, you know, aspect of it, and doesn't like the fact that the people that were Reylo before the movie came out, because I was not one of them. I didn't think it was going to go this way. I was like Luke, you know, listening to Luke. This is not going to go the way that you think. Yeah, apparently not. I'm absolutely glad that it went this way, but I was not expecting that it was going to, that The Last Jedi was going to end up being this sort of Reylo-centric film that it was, and I don't think that sits well with a lot of people. I think people still are weary going back to the Twilight films, and it's something that a lot of people aren't comfortable with. Obviously, people, as we mentioned before, it's not just that. There's also people just didn't like the movie, didn't like the decisions that were made, don't like milking space cows. Okay, that's fine, to each their own. But I think J.J. Abrams, you know, has a bit of a point that people, you know, were threatened by that, didn't like it, weren't comfortable, probably with themselves, because that's usually what happens when people end up being threatened by silly things like that. He also said that the direction of Episode 9 would not be dictated based off of any of the backlash, which to me is good news if we're looking to see more, you know, Rey and Kylo having to come to grips with who they are and what they are to one another. J.J. Abrams also came out and has said that the script for Episode 9 is done. He and Chris Terrio have finished the script, and this is somewhat different than what he is used to dealing with, because a lot of times J.J. said he doesn't have a script before the movie starts, and certainly he and Lawrence Kasdan were still doing a lot of writing on The Last Jedi before that, while they were filming it. They didn't have a full script, so it starts shooting in July, and he's already got a script. The part of that that really gets me giddy is that the story's out there. That's just cool to me, knowing that out there in the ether, right, the story for Episode 9 in its current iteration exists. Somebody, including J.J. Abrams, Chris Terrio, and others, know how this whole thing is going to end. And that's cool to me. It's cool to think that there are people out there that know how this trilogy is going to end. You know, I'd say jealousy, but I'm cool to wait. We got Han Solo coming up here in a couple of months, and then I like the hype and everything leading into it. I just think it's really cool that there are people out there that know how this is going to end, and the story now exists. And I honestly, I'm like Luke, man. I feel this way.
This is not going to go the way you think.
Yeah, because I don't know how this is going to go, and I'm really, really eager to find out. All right, so let's move over to, just for a few minutes, let's talk a little Rebels. Sound like a good idea?
Fulfill your destiny.
All right, I don't talk about Rebels much on the show. I usually stick to the movies. However, we are into the final episodes of, oh my gosh, we're getting one tonight. I totally forgot. It'll be up too late for me to watch it tonight, but I will be able to watch it tomorrow. If you haven't watched last week's Rebels, then don't listen for the next, like, 5 minutes. Okay, because I'm going to do a lot of spoiling, so don't listen to it. All right, but all right, you had enough time. This last week of Rebels and the passing of Kanan, I know that a majority of the characters and Rebels are probably going to bite it in these final episodes. We've got another two-parter tonight, and then I think we're down to, what, the hour-and-a-half finale? I think that's it. We know for sure that Hera makes it, because she's been featured in other canon material outside of Rebels. I mean, even into, I mean, obviously Rogue One, but there's stuff out there with Forces of Destiny where she's a part of the, you know, the Death Star 2 battle in Endor. So we know that Hera makes it. I was not expecting Kanan to go out so soon. It was pretty clear within the episode in which he died that it was heading that direction. I will say this, I've never had an animated TV show, or I want to say movie, but that's not true. I've had animated films make me cry before. I think Frozen might have. I cried everything though. But I've never had an animated TV show gut me the way that episode did. Dave Filoni, who directs those and did Clone Wars and did Rebels, he just does such a fantastic job. These are such great characters, and the way that he had Kanan, the setup leading into it, you know that this was going to go a certain way. The connection in that moment where they had Hera, who is arguably my favorite Rebels character. Ahsoka and Hera, but Hera is really vying for the top spot of my favorite non-Star Wars movie canon character. I just absolutely love that character. The fact they put her in a position where she was dealing with trauma because the probe droid, right, had the mind probe had affected her while she was in custody of the Empire. And so she was opening up, that they used that device to have her open up to Kanan in a way that she hadn't before, because she'd been so guarded. It was so good and so emotional. And then for him to go and sacrifice himself to save the rest of them and his friends. Yeah, man, I was bawling like a little kid. It made me cry right now. And it was sad. It was good. Just really good, solid storytelling. And, you know, if that's the opening salvo for these last couple of episodes, man, I'm keeping the tissues nearby, because it's just really, really, really good stuff. And I'm excited for what comes next after Rebels. There was a marketing, copyright. Disney Lucasfilm ended up copywriting Star Wars Resistance. So there is a lot of speculation in the fandom right now that Resistance is going to be the next iteration. So maybe we'll get another animated series, but this one will be based on the Resistance, which could be really, really interesting. If we're getting stuff that's pre, say, The Force Awakens, that we see some of the fight prior to The Force Awakens, there's a lot of ground, obviously, that can be covered between episode 6 and episode 7. I think that's, you know, and the characters that we can be introduced to now that we already know them in episode 7 and 8, when you think of Poe, when you think of Kylo Ren, right? When you think of Leia, I mean, all these characters we can go back and visit at a time when the Resistance is formed. We can go back and, you know, revisit Holdo. I think that's really, really good territory. Could be, potentially, there's going to be a live-action TV show. Honestly, I haven't been reading a lot of the speculation, so it may have been discounted already. Somebody may have found evidence that's not the case. But without seeing that, I'll just throw out the possibility that could be what the live-action TV show might end up being. But again, great, great stuff from Rebels. Really looking forward to these last handfuls, this last handful of episodes. And again, going to keep my tissues handy.
I've seen this raw strength only once before. It didn't scare me enough then. It does now.
All right, we might have time to get into a few of your posts from YouTube and the emails that you've sent me before we wrap the show up. I do want to mention one thing about Han Solo. Boy, not a lot of hype. And this is obviously, the marketing is interesting. We're a very short ways away from this movie being released towards the end of May. We've gotten these two teasers now. I like the teasers. This, you know, the Solo, a Star Wars story, has it has even less sort of weight than even Rogue One did. I mean, Rogue One obviously had the direct connection to A New Hope and stealing of the Death Star plans, and there's some curiosity there. It's in the crawl of A New Hope, right? I can't wait to see this movie. I'll see it opening day, and then I'll see it the day after, and who knows how many times I'll see it in theaters. But again, it's got a, compared to the other Star Wars movies that have been released, so those got an uphill battle, not just because of the fact that you got a newish actor playing the most iconic character, not just in Star Wars, but in sort of cinema history, who was originally played by the most iconic actor living currently in modern cinema in Harrison Ford. This movie's got a lot up against it. And I like the teaser trailers, but they didn't give us really much to chew on. And so I expect that when the full trailer gets released, which nobody is talking about, by the way, we have to get some type of full trailer to get a general idea, because they called this a teaser. So to me, that indicates that we'll be getting a full trailer at some point in time. When that full trailer comes out, I imagine we're going to get a much, much better understanding and feel and vibe for this movie. And in its defense, look, when the first Last Jedi teaser came out, was released, it was lackluster. I mean, in retrospect, I loved it because it was Star Wars and because of I love these characters, but it really gave us next to nothing in terms of anything to really chew on. I mean, we were all kind of grasping to make anything of that original teaser trailer. And this is kind of par for the course for what Disney does. And so, I'm really looking forward to the movie. There isn't a lot of buzz and hype around it. And maybe that's part of the design. Hopefully when we get this full trailer, that will change. One thing that's really interesting to note is that there's been some toy fairs going on and a bunch of toys have been released, for Solo, and there's just really cool looking stuff, and there's the Falcon, the old newer Falcon, and some of the panels pop off of the toy, which indicates that at some point during the movie we're gonna see why it looks all polished and clean in the trailers and then it ends up looking like what a piece of junk when we get to A New Hope. And I'm pretty sure that's actually been stated by Ron Howard, that we'll see it's part of the movie. We'll end up seeing why it ends up looking the way that it does. There's one thing that I just thought was really cool, and I really like vehicles. Talked about this before. Love the vehicles. Love the diecast vehicles. Okay, reminds me of when I was a kid. There's one particular diecast vehicle that's for this Imperial cruiser, and it's got this sort of wedgish shape with these three massive arrays, right? These big circular, you know, arrays, one elongated out in front and two off to the side of this wedge shape with a tower in the back. And they call this Imperial cruiser. That cruiser, that design was actually taken from an original Star Destroyer design done by a concept artist prior to when Ralph McQuarrie came on board. And if you go back and look at some of that original artwork, it looks really trippy, just because it's such a far cry from what we saw and what we were so used to seeing and are used to seeing from McQuarrie's work. But that's what this ship is taken from, and I dig that. I just thought that was really cool. Somebody put a side-by-side of that original piece of art, which was supposed to be indicative of what this particular artist thought a Star Destroyer looked like, and it looked really sort of thin and flimsy. What they've gone and done with this Imperial cruiser for the Solo movie, I just thought was super cool. And I've liked all of the designs that I've seen so far. You know, the speeders that we've seen, the look of it looks absolutely fantastic. But I get a really big kick out of the fact that Disney and Lucasfilm go back and they pull from so many of these other pieces of work to go and create the new stuff. I think that's really cool. And what I also like about that too is that they are building new things, but you know, there's you've got so much to pull from what was created from the original trilogy. I imagine at some point they'll start pulling from concepts that were also done with the prequels. And then you've got all these artists that are going to be creating brand new things that we've never seen before, especially when you think about what the Game of Thrones writers will be doing with their series of films, what Rian Johnson will be doing with his trilogy. I mean, look, it's the one thing the Star Wars just gets right across the board and can do no wrong and hasn't done any wrong, in my opinion. It's just the design aesthetic. The world building that Star Wars does across the board is hands down the best world building of any series in my opinion. And that's just my opinion. I know other people like Harry Potter and all that, but no, it is absolutely the best. All right, so a couple of things before we wrap up. I got just enough time to squeak in a couple of your comments, and so let's get to it. First one comes from somebody, Mike. Mike emailed into me. Mike MK2121 says, "Love your podcast and the positive attitude. Thank you." Talked about last week the continuity errors of the films, right? Especially Kylo's mask at the beginning of how it moves from shot to shot at the beginning of The Force Awakens. He says, "One thing that drives me crazy about The Force Awakens is you can see the red glow of Kylo's lightsaber before he ignites it to strike down Lor San Tekka. Drives me crazy. And now I have to watch to see the things that you were talking about. Thanks again for the great show." I haven't watched The Force Awakens since Mike emailed, so I'm kind of hoping I forget before I see it again, because it's probably going to take me out of the movie. All right, Serial Chiller writes on a YouTube. "I love these movies so much. Also love listening to your podcast. Thank you. They're seriously awesome. Thank you again. Watch TFA, and you'll notice that when Finn goes over to Rey after Kylo throws her into the tree, she moves her leg without Finn touching it." Why am I reading these? Serial Chiller says, "It's so annoying, especially because the end battle scene is my absolute favorite part of that movie. Also, the whole Chewie and Leia not acknowledging each other when they come back from Starkiller is really lame. Rian made up for that in The Last Jedi. I went to go see The Last Jedi for my sixth viewing. May the Force be with you." You know what's really funny? That never bothered me at the end of, and that's all we have time for the commentary. I will start off next week's show before we do the deep dive on the novel. Okay, I promise. With the other listener feedback of what you send me between now and then. I want to mention that Chewie and Leia scene at the end of The Force Awakens never ever bothered me. And that's only because I guess it should have, but I guess there's a part of me. This is going to sound horrible. What a horrible way to wrap the podcast up. There's a part of me that still sees Chewie as kind of like their big, huge, furry, lovable pet. I don't know. I know he's not. But I just didn't. It didn't bother me. I kind of just felt that, you know, Chewbacca was way concerned about making sure that Finn was okay. And Rey was coming off the Falcon, and so Leia was obviously connecting with her, you know, more so than he wanted to go, and you know, and they hugged earlier in the movie when they went to Taco Nana, so I didn't have a problem with it. So anyway, all right, hey, thanks for checking out episode number 112? Yeah, episode number 112. Back next week. I won't take a week off, I promise. I hope you have a fantastic week. Again, if you can, subscribe. iTunes, Spreaker, Stitcher, Podbean, as I mentioned before. YouTube, drop me a comment. I greatly appreciate it. And I hope you enjoyed listening to this week's show as much as I enjoyed recording it. It was cathartic for me, and my day is already going better. So until I have a chance to talk to you guys next week, may the Force be with you. Always.
My Nerd World.